There are many challenges today. I don't mean in the world, but in this room. One is that I'm working without the PowerPoint. And the second one is I had a pharyngitis until yesterday. No voice at all. I self-prescribed some antibiotics. I hope they will help me to speak loudly at least for about an hour. So I don't have a PowerPoint, I will show you what I do. When I read about the idea behind the conference, I thought that there were three parts of my working progress. Next book I'm going to publish on social movements in times of austerity, which may fit to a certain extent the topics you are interested in. And so what I would like to do is to present these three ideas. One is the ideas that's about the, what we can do, that there are some times in which there is an intensification of protest, and times in which the unexpected happens. So what I want to show is that several of recent movements, which played an important role in denouncing what was behind the crisis, they were unexpected in terms of the theories which are available in social movement studies, but could develop because, and this is the reason for the title of the presentation, they were eventful in the sense that they could construct resources. Second issues I want to address is the fact that these movements had to face a very specific forms of capitalism. Capitalism has not been studied much in social movement studies, but I think it is time to bring in reflections on capitalism in order to understand the new movements as sort of adaptations and reactions to the type of capitalism which developed in the last few years. And third, what I want to do, if I still have voice and time after these first 2 points, is to say that one of the elements which we can look at in order to analyze the type of challenges and resources that this movement represents in nowadays time is about their conceptions of democracies, about the ways in which they innovate, also vis-à-vis recent movements like the global justice movement, and to which extent these innovations in their conceptions of participatory and deliberative democracies can be seen as related with the first two issues. So to, their capacity to prefigure new types of societies on the one end and on the other end, their need to adapt to changing situations related with and changing challenges related with the changes in democracies. So this was my first pictures. These are pictures in which in Spain an activist as a poster, le llaman democracia y no lo es. They call it democracy, but it is not. And this is a main characterization of these movements, of the left-wing movements during the austerity protest which I'm studying, which are not movements against democracies, they are not movements challenging the idea of democracies, but rather deepening the idea of democracies and challenging the ideas that what we are facing in this moment is a democratic. They are challenging the idea that what we have now under neoliberalism, the post-democracy Colin Crouch was talking about, is something which respects the very principle of democratic development. Second slide. Democracy in the squares. There were several movements in social movement studies, we are always waiting for the next wave of protest because it brings interest in the topic. And after 2001, the big wave of protest of the global justice movements, there had been a sort of retreat of protest. But then in 2011, we had a lot of movements which were all characterized as surplus. So there were counter-revolutions like in the Arab Springs. They were called deep challenges like in the Indignados movement. There were movements which have been characterized in different ways, movements of the squares, for instance, because they introduced innovations in terms of the image of protest, like being not just marching, but also talking in the squares. So January 25th, 2011, the Tahrir Square. 15th of May, 2011, Puerto del Sol in Madrid. 25th of May, 2011, Sintagma Squares in Athens. September 17, 2011, Sukkoti Park in New York City. What do these movements represent? And then later on, also other protesters took the same type of forms. They represented large mobilizations, massive mobilizations, which were usually unexpected by the organizers themselves. On the 25th of January, the Egyptian police and the Egyptian activists expected a normal type of demonstrations, which means a few hundreds of police makes arrests and so on. And instead, they increased enormously. Same is true for the Indignados in Spain. Same is true for the Greeks, which were considered to be late in mobilizing, and also Occupy in the United States was not really expected. This is the first issue which I think is important. There are some times in which the unexpected happens. There are some times in which the high risks of protest in authoritarian regimes doesn't count any longer to thwart mobilizations, but on the contrary, produces moral shocks and brings people in the street. Which are the explanations, first of all, for this protest? Because this is relevant also in order to analyze protest on austerities. In social movement studies, one of the expectations is people do not protest when they are more frustrated, but when they have resources. Labor studies testifies that the strength of the labor movement is not in the moment of iron employment, but it is in the moment in which resources are available. So these movements tend to be a challenge not only to governors, but also to social movement theories, because they happen in situations of big challenges to mobilization itself. We have two theories available, and I want to suggest the third one in order to grasp what's there in when movement appears so unexpectedly. One explanation has been developed at the micro level, for instance by Kuran, when trying to understand why in Eastern Europe in 1989 suddenly the Soviet Union bloc fell down. How did it happen? While all the Sovietologists had predicted that the one-party system authoritarian regimes were there to stay, instead there was suddenly this fall. And at the micro level, what has been said is that there is a change in the type of game which is played. So from the rational choice perspective, game theories, the idea is that the more people mobilize, the more costs and benefits changes. Kuran described the presence of two different types of preferences, especially in authoritarian regimes, a public one and a private one. And repression makes that when you are afraid of speaking up, you don't present in public complaints against the regimes. And so you also don't know how widespread they are. Well, in 1989, there were several signals that indicated that people were dissatisfied. For instance, I happened to be in Berlin at that time, and there were the big waves of so-called exiters, those who wanted to leave the countries, occupied embassies, and so on. The idea in this type of approach is that you move from zero-sum to self-insurance gains, and this also means that when you start to see people on the street, your costs are reduced. Repression is more difficult when there are masses, even for military regimes and so on. And the benefits tend to increase because you expect to be praised by your friends, for instance, for what you are doing. There is some truth, I think, in these explanations, but I don't think it explains all because the dynamics are more collective than individuals. But it is true that if you look at the news in Maidan, on Gezi Parks, or recent moments of protest, what people are saying is, I have to be there, because otherwise I cannot explain to my son, to my daughter, why I didn't participate. So suddenly, what used to be a sort of strong constraints of protest, jeopardizing mobilization, becomes something that instead you have to do. It's the effect of the moral shock. So there is this explanation at the micro level. There is another explanation at the macro level, which has been developed by the so-called transitologist school in democratization studies, O'Donnell, Schmutter, and others. They suggested that while we are usually in normal times oriented to try to explain what happens on the basis of the type of preconditions, sufficient causes, and so on, that there are times in which these explanations do not work or work much worse than they work in normal time. They don't work because they are based on the assumptions that people tend to react rationally, that they know what's going to happen and that they have sort of rules to apply. While these moments of sudden mobilizations are moments in which Schmitter and O'Donnell said, actors have to bet. So there are moments which are understructured and they don't know what the situation, what the others will do. So there are moments which represent challenges to the normal expectations of people. There are moments in which contingency counts much more than usually. There are moments in which there are conditions, but the conditions are suddenly and quickly changed. So macro level. I want, together with other scholars in social movement studies, try to add to these explanations a level of explanations which is more related with the major level, with the level of social movements as collective actors. So it is true they act in some moments in situations in which they do not how people will react. How will the military react in Egypt? How will the police react in Spain? But also, how will other actors take position? How will normal people react? And there are, in social movement studies, some reflections which I think are useful to understand oppositional actors in this moment of crisis. One is the idea by Sewell, historian and sociologist, that there are three temporalities in the social sciences. Are you familiar?
Thanks.
I think it's interesting because it says we have a way to use time which is a sort of times in evolutionary, times in the long perspective. Organization, which we use, modernization, democratizations, and so on, all expect evolutions in times from less to more. There is a way to use time as a sort of experiments. So traditional historical sociology, looking at Vandermeer and others, looking at the ways in which some processes differ in different areas according to some different conditions. But what he points at, and I think it's relevant for us to try to understand times of crisis, is what he calls eventful time. So while the, our assumptions that events are constrained by conditions, what he stresses is the fact that there are some events which tend to the opposite, to construct structures. He studied in particular the Bastille takeover. But we could consider events like the acampadas and so on also as events which are these eventful dimensions. So, if we think in terms of social movement theories, they have very little resources. Neoliberalism had already destroyed a lot of the traditional associations, organizations which have made formal organizations in the past. Very often they represent the losers of the development of neoliberalism. And they live in a society which is fragmented, fluid, and so on. So if we think in terms of social movements as using resources, this movement should not be there. If they are there, it's because they can also produce, to a large extent, their own resources. And what Sewell says is that in this intense time, the ways in which protest happens, the ways in which this event develops, make for their capacity to change structures. Another interesting suggestion, I know that yesterday you discussed about nationalism. There is a book by Mark Basinger on the breakdown of the Soviet Union, in which he distinguished between nationalism and in times, in normal times, let's say, path dependent, building up on past history, but also nationalism is in intense time, in which many things have changed. And what he says is these are times in which contingency, agency, whatever you want to use for this, counts. So in which structures, it's not that they do not count, but they count less. The first thing I wanted to say. According to social movement studies, you have preconditions like social structures. You have the need for mobilizing resources. So you have the need for organizations, which are no longer the organizations of the labor movement, but are the networks of you need allies in the political system, and you need a capacity to construct identities, to frame your ideas, to frame the definitions of the enemy, and so on. And then comes protest. My claim is that this is important, but that in some time, especially in intense time, we should also go the other way around, in the sense of considering protest notice the effect of resources, but not using resources, but able to reproduce these resources by through the creation of alliances in action, through the creation of resource organizational resources in actions, through the creations of frames which adapt to the existing one. In the nowadays movements, what do they have to face and to try to transform? Second part of the presentation. And fourth slide. Is, I said the subtitle of this new book is Bringing Capitalism Back into Social Movement Studies. Because a friend and colleague of mine, Jeff Goodwin, wrote a couple of years ago a paper, which I found very stimulating. The title was The Strange Disappearance of Capitalism from Social Movement Studies. And he's a student of revolutions. In revolutions, it was important to understand which degrees of capitalist development was there. But in social movement studies, reflections on the big structural transformations have been forgotten the development in the last 30 years or so. They've been forgotten for some good reasons to a certain extent. First, social movement studies developed in a sort of, not opposition, but challenge on the ideas developed on previous social movements. So they developed with Roberto Melucci, Alain Touraine, and others around the ideas that societies were changing, that they were becoming post-industrial, post-modern, or whatever. And so they say you have to single out the characteristics of the new actors of these societies. And one of the ideas was also that these actors were not so much defined in terms of their structural location, of their type of exploitations and so on, but rather that they were defined on the basis of beliefs, environmentalism, women's movement, and so on. And that they were, Klaus Hofer also suggested, quite different from the movements of the past in trying to develop new forms of organizations which were in tension with the forms of organizations of the labor movement of the past. This was the period in which social movement studies were in Europe very much influenced by the so-called new social movements type of approach. And the idea then was that social movements of the past, the labor movement, is co-opted into the Fordist system. And now the challenge comes from other places. The labor movement was forgotten in this, in part because the labor movement itself in some areas changed, relied less on type of social movements resources and more on institutional types of resources, but in part also I think because, as it happens in the social sciences, different fields were built and the communications at the borders was reduced. The other reactions from social movement studies that for a moment jeopardized the possibility to reflect about structural basis of protest was especially in the United States, the reactions against the so-called strength theories or frustration theories which explain social movements on the basis of level of dissatisfaction. And since the beginning, social movement studies tended to notice that it is not when you are the most frustrated, it's not when, when you are in the worst conditions that you are capable of reacting. Can we some other type of research in social movements, which stressed instead the potential for social movements developed in times of crisis, but these were not very much considered by social movement scholars. I'm referring here especially to two streams of research, which tried to understand to which extent changing structures do affect protest. One is Karl Polanyi's work, and Polanyi talked of movements and counter-movements, defining a sort of the movements against liberal great transformations is a sort of natural reactions in this eternal struggle between free market and social protections. So Polanyi did expect movements to react to big structural development, but especially in a reactive forms, especially like movement defending social protections of the past. P. Thompson's work on the riots tend to follow also this type of explanations. Liberalism as neoliberal forms tend to withdraw rights which have been given to people and people react to them. Another school that tried to understand movements in times of crisis, but also quite separated from social movement style studies, is world system theories. Wallerstein and others who looked at the ways in which waves of strikes and so on tend to follow moments of big transformations, but again without connections. My impression is that social movement studies could now interact well with these different other theories, bringing in some resources. In my view, Polanyi's Wallerstein tended to give very good suggestions, instruments to analyze nowadays movements, but they tended to remain quite structuralist in their views. Social movement studies can take from them the reflections on structures, but it could also put in some more reflections on the ways in which agencies work within this type of structures. So, reflection on which type of capitalism social movements have to react to. I think here I found a lot of inspirations in Polanyi's work, because if you look at the great transformations, talking about the first development of liberalism, free market ways, and you compare with what happened since late 80s and the 90s, you see a lot of parallels. So from development of movements from free markets, quite ideological type of movements, which gain a lot of power, you have the development of a form of capitalism which denies the previous spirit of capitalism. Chapelon was a key definition. So you have a type of capitalism which becomes much more cynical in predicting the need for a total free market to trump over any type of protections. And you see in many countries privatizations, deregulations type of policies is following the same types of logic and reducing a lot the capacities of the state to respond to social movement demands, challenges, and so on. So nowadays, I come from Southern Europe, so it's a view which is particularly strong in these regions, but what you face is not about which social movement is reflected in the 80s, in the 70s and the 80s. But it is a very different form of capitalism in which you have dominance of free markets and reductions. At the practical level and at the symbolic level of a lot of the state competences, which were important in the development of previous social movements. So social movements have to react to a situation of capitalism, which in terms of social movement structures means that it is no longer a two-thirds society of privileged people, but it is rather two-thirds societies of losers of globalization. So we have collected data on about 50 demonstrations, social movements, protests in times of austerity. And those who participate in this protest is not the ruled class. The forest state was considered as the state in which the working class became the ruled class. Nowadays you have a development in which the middle class becomes precarious working class. And in this several protests we started, we put questions, asked questions about self-locations in terms of social class, as well as the traditional questions on professions, positions in the labor market, and so on. And what was very clear, especially in southern countries, is that those who protest feed themselves on the losing side of neoliberalism, globalization, and so on. It is no longer what new social movement studies considered as the main constituencies of social movements. The new middle class involved in public services and so on. The very conceptions of labor changed a lot. Precarity is the main terms, and in fact, one of the issues we discussed is this a movement of precarious people? Precarity is a very central concept to understand these movements, but not in the sense that these movements are made only of the young precarious people who didn't get into the central labor market yet. No, precarity is something which started to spread because even those categories which in the past were considered and considered themselves as part of the core labor, the secure status and so on, readiness, people working in big industries, especially people working for the states. These are not only secure, when governments like those in Spain are forced to cut 25% of the salaries in education and so on. This means that also what we used to consider the secure side of the labor market is no longer secure. And so these movements mobilize people who are precarious, not only in restricted core meaning of precarity, but because precarity nowadays is evolving, as we standing also shows, not all conditions in entering the job markets, in staying within the market, and later on in all the aspects of the societies, which involves more and more people. And these people protest. So second, someone stops me doing this. In second challenge, and attempt to see how these movements are reacting to this challenge. Political opportunity structures. In the past, it was clear social movements were trade unions and left-wing parties with distinctions, divisions, tensions, and so on, but we're on the same side. New social movements, this changed. There were more tensions with political parties. Nevertheless, it was clear that some types of alliances resisted. Some parties tended to present themselves or representatives of new leaders, the Greens. Some parties transformed themselves in order to meet some demands coming from the new social movements. And there was still some alliances between center-left party politics and social movements demands. There were not easy channels of access to the political decisions, but still more. These movements tend instead to react to what one could call with the Habermas of the past, a crisis of legitimacy. Habermas in the 70s had talked of a crisis of legitimacy which came from the sort of politizations of the rationality crisis in the economy, became a crisis of legitimacy because the foreign state intervened in the economy. I think what this movement reacted to is rather a crisis of responsibility of political institutions, which are no longer available to respond to the demands of their citizens. And these movements are insisting a lot, you could say in a Polanyist type of way, on existing rights. In the past, authoritarian regimes as well as democratic regimes, the so-called developmental regimes in the South and the social democratic regimes in the North, and even the Eastern Democratic parties in southern regions, they had accepted some sort of standard of citizenship rights. Health, education, housing, jobs were considered by the people to be rights, to be deeply appreciated as rights. And if you look at anti-austerity protests in Latin America, starting already in the 80s and especially in the 90s, or if you look at Tahrir squares or Tunisia, the claims for dignity that these social movements put forward are claims that reflect the rudeness and the spread of these conceptions of rights that the neoliberal type of political institutions tend to deny. So what Colin Crouch calls post-democracies is a type of democracies which doesn't include in its conceptions the respect of citizenship rights, which for the people are instead rights to be defended. And these issues of health, education, lodging, housing, and jobs, this type of rights, are very strongly present in this type of movements. Together with this defense of rights, there is a very strong, much stronger than even in 2001, reactions against a type of political class which, according to research in many different fields of the social sciences, but also to the appreciations of the people, is more and more defined as corrupted. Neoliberalism had promised that reducing the interventions of the state in the market, this would have solved the problem of corruption. This would have separated two spheres. Thus, Occupy people in the United States, taking over the slogan by Stalin's on the 1% against the 99%, are describing democracies which go back from the stage of pluralism into a very elitarian state. And you see this Italy, in my country, it was a typical example with the figure of Berlusconi, of this elite which puts together economic and political power. But this is only one example. In nowadays societies, the continuous shift from market to politics, the convergence of resources in the two areas, the development of instrument of pantouflage, the conflicts of interest, and so on, are deeply affecting systems which we believed they were quite set clean. Germany, the United States itself, were systems that were not considered as particularly untransparent. But what these movements tend to point at is the fact that the states are not only irresponsible in not recognizing rights, they are not only imposing indignities on movements that call for dignity, but they are also deeply corrupted because they are, forgetting about the very principle of their own type of democracy, so of what representative forms of democracy were building upon. These movements then tend to construct alternative identities against political system in which they don't see any possible alliance. While the movement of another data from our surveys, movement of 2001-2002, which we start already the global justice movement, they were quite critical of political parties, but in our surveys about 25% of the people trusted parties were members of. In our surveys now, Italy and Spain, the percentage of people who participate in anti-austerity protests and trust political parties is below 5%, and below 1% if you look at the young people. So these movements have to construct on big disappointment with democracy, which is all the opinion polls say is not a disappointment with the essence of democracy, but a disappointment with the really existing type of democracy. And these movements need to build new type of definitions of the people, the citizens, the nation, and so on. If you think about the slogans of the 2011 movement, also about the choreography of these movements. Movements of 2001, which represented movements in neoliberalism, but still in its peak, were going back to concepts, values, which were widespread in the left, solidarity, justice, and so on. These new movements have a tendency to challenge the ideas of right and left. They tend to be all movements which are very rooted in the history of the left, but at the same time searching for new type of definition. Ernesto Latrao talks of populist reasons, like the need to build up identities in challenging times. So these movements react to fluid societies, to precarity. Bauman's liquid type of societies, and they do it by attempting to develop very broad definitions of the state. There was also a debate within some of these movements about definitions like we are the 99%. the global justice movement of the beginning of the new millennium took over the Zapatistas' slogans of "We are a sum, we are a network of minorities." We represent the minorities of the different minorities, gender, national, and so on, of the globe. These movements tend to present identities which aim at encompassing much broader types of groups. The 99%. Also, the slogans of the Arab Spring was always "We the people." Many of these movements referred to the citizens at large. Choreographically, the global justice movement used the rainbow flag, which was a flag of many colors, which was taken by the gay, from the gay movement or the peace movement, graphically to represent, choreographically to represent this plurality. What happened in these movements is that often national symbols were used. The Iceland flag, which we had probably none of us knew about in the past, became a flag well known in all the squares. Greek flags were used in the syntagma. Symbols of nations which were not used, however, in an exclusive way, but to represent a sort of need for and defense of sovereignty against the constraining powers coming from outside, coming from Germany, the European Union, and so on. One minute, the very last point. I said it also has an effect on democracy. And in 1 minute, I try to represent it once again choreographically. Movements of the past were marching in the street, and protests tended to be conceived as an instrument to put pressures on authorities and so on. Nowadays, movements, if you look at many books written on Iñárritu and others, Maidan, Gezi Parks, and so on, these are movements who sit in, made of people who sit in squares. And it has a deep meaning. In fact, not by chance, many of these movements tended to be deeply disrupted by police interventions that took them away from the squares. The squares meant participation, but of a different type than in the global justice movement. Much stronger in this movement, the idea is normal people as to participate. We not only do not recognize the influence of parties, but we also do not recognize the influence of previous generations of social movement organizations, ATTAC, or whatever new forms of social movement organizations. We want the affected to participate. And this is a different types of conceptions, the participations of the people as such, that the squares represent. The squares is open, it's an open space. The global justice movement used to have its clue in the global social forum, European social forums, which were held in spaces which were open to all, but which were closed spaces. They were former airport in Athens, or the Fortezza d'Ambasto in Florence. When this movement meet on the squares, the meaning is we meet in a place which is open to all. And I think, and this is the last word, that what is interesting in this attempt is that they tend to reflect also this sort of strongly declining trust in the political system through a strongly organize the squares to the squares according to alternative values. It's a bit, once again, like the Zapatista sinister and Acadona. But they wanted to do it also in the main squares of our cities. This could be a sign of weakness or a way of working on weaknesses, but I think it's a sign of innovations which is important to keep in mind when looking at this process. Yes. Thank you.
I think what we're going to do is just so everyone does have a chance to ask some questions, is we'll maybe go until about 10 past. Have some questions go, and then make that time up during the coffee break, so that people do get a chance to ask some questions, and then they get a chance to respond. So I'll let you select who to answer from, as you wish, one or three.
The first one was very excited to hear your talk.
Okay, very, 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 I speak that. I leave Italy out, but I think there's some things that are common in social movements in, both in Portugal and Greece and Spain, so as I understand it. I think there's an important thing which is, I would call the polyphony of the street, that comes a little bit from the idea of the social forums and different subjects come together, but there is a new quality, I would say, or a certain centrality today, which is focused on the questions of precarity and the crisis and austerity. I think there is a lot of the idea in the new social movements of somehow empowering the powerless. For example, the Stop Movie Evictions campaign in Spain, or the networks of solidarity in Greece, or throwing down the government, or in Portugal when we were able to stop one of the austerity packages. And the third thing that you didn't comment, and I would, you did, but I would like maybe a longer comment about, is that I think that both in these three countries, there was the need to find a way of institutional representation. So in both of these three countries, there is the growth, or more or less, at different timings, of brother-left parties that have somehow reflected the experience of the movements and the demands of the movements.
You are right. In the book, there is an ambiguity which reflects the different opinions between myself and my friend Mario Diani about the role of protest. I am more protester in the sense that I think that social movements are not only there in the moment of protesting, they do many different things, and protest usually takes much less than the book, which is called Democracies and Endless Meeting, talking about social movements. And it is true that what we social movement activists do is more talking than marching. But I think that forms of protest are especially important in producing these type of resources. So emotional mechanisms are extremely important. We, in social movement studies, for a long time, we said social movements are normal actors in the sense that you cannot consider them as irrational. Okay, but it is also true that going to Tahrir is different emotionally than just going to vote in Italy or in other countries. So I think that forms of protest, like it was the case for the labor movement in the past, are important in order to push for new visions of participations. Participatory push in the labor movement often came in moments of strikes, the long strikes of the past, which were quite different than the short, as Michel Perron talks about the strikes in France, showing how these moments were important in order, she said, to leave the desires for the struggle. Because when they finished, so probably also with the general strikes is similar, they leave the desire for that intense moment of struggle. And I think this emotional atmosphere is particularly important, and for many movements created by some forms of protest. But it is true also that there could be different types of protests. For instance, we focused on usually political type of movement. But there are movements more oriented towards cultural activities and so on, for which forms of resistance do not take the characteristics of protest, but maybe as important as the other in terms of creating passions and emotions. And I think that it is a very important transformative power of protest events, the work on emotions, which is sometimes strategically done and sometimes it happens during the event, but transformations of fear in anger, transformations of frustrations in hope, is extremely important in creating an atmosphere in which people want to participate. The social media is very important, but what the activists always suggest is that you cannot really distinguish between the role of the different medias, but you have to see the integrated roles of communication. So social medias were extremely important in spreading information. So, Jeff Judis said they allowed to move from a logic of network to a logic of aggregation, in which while the new social movements of the past, websites and so on, needed organizations, the new social media, Facebook, Twitter, and so on, can be used by any activist. This played an important role. Julius says also something important. Aggregation happens quickly, fast, with this type of new media. But it doesn't last, because in the long term one also needs organizations. And here is the role also of new parties, which is interesting to see that notwithstanding this deep mistrust in politics, in several countries activists started also to construct new parties. Podemos in Spain, Syriza, in Greece, but even the Five Stars movement in Italy represent these attempts to rebuild party politics as well. In the next conference,
once again, thank you so much.